goodness, and there are some amazing people in this room tonight. So if you want to look in your gallery view and see all the wonderful people here, I saw John de Villiers in here. I saw Jan de Koenen. Jan, thank you for all your great press coverage that you've given us. I saw Mary Storer here all the way from Natal with her entire family around you. Welcome, Mary. Nikita, one of our biggest supporters. Nikita, wonderful to have you here. Dillian Swart, Jason van Slot, Bashara, all of you, most welcome. It's 6 minutes in, Dean. I'm going to start it if that's okay with you. I'm not going to do another one. Not going to do another song, so let's start it. For those of you that are looking to see this strange, beautiful scarf that I'm wearing, this is the latest fashion accessory from the Players Fund. It is a mask commemorating the 1995 World Cup. It's really, really well made. It's an excellent quality item, and it's available at all Pick and Pay stores. I think this one was 50 Rand, which I think is an absolute bargain. Tonight, you are in the right place if you're looking for some entertainment. This is I think it's the eighth of a series, and we've had some incredible speakers here from John de Villiers, Skulk, John Smith. We've had the 95 World Cup, four of those players, all kinds of amazing players, all in aid of one thing. When COVID started, as all professional speakers, Dean and myself were instantaneously unemployed, and Dean went and spoke to the Players Fund, and they have been massively supportive in getting us some of the biggest names in rugby, and we have had an absolutely fantastic series, and we will tell you a little bit later, there is one more to come, and so it's a big thing. So, but let me just quickly, without any further ado, share with you our interviewer tonight. Our interviewer is a professional speaker. He is born in England, but if you listen to his heart, he is more South African than most of us. He absolutely adores this country. He loves his rugby. He loves his sport. He's a doctor. He's an historian. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for Dr. Dean Allen.
Andre, thank you so much for that lovely introduction. It's a Thursday evening again, and here we are with another one of our wonderful rugby interviews. And it's been a great week. I hope everybody has had a decent week. I know these are strange times, and thank you for joining us on these Thursday evenings and making them a regular part of your week. It's been a good week for me. It was my birthday yesterday, and in fact, it's my sister's birthday today. So I'm going to wish her a happy birthday all the way there back in England. She's a good rugby player herself, actually. She represented Southwest Districts of England. So happy birthday, Lisa. Tonight, it's a really special evening. Not only are we going to be interviewing one of the legends of South African rugby, but a current World Cup winner. Isn't that a great thing to say? Somebody who's actually part of the team that won that trophy last year. But before we go any further, this is a special evening. It's slightly different because tonight we're going to be welcoming a different audience. I know we've got our loyal supporters there, but tonight we're part of the wonderful Knysna Oyster Festival, which this year, unfortunately, because of COVID-19, has had to go virtual. So if you're watching us as a result of picking up on the stream as part of the Knysna Oyster Festival, welcome. I am actually just up the road from Knysna. I'm doing this presentation from Wilderness, would you believe, on the beautiful Garden Route. And as you know, there's no better place in the world than the Garden Route of South Africa. I'd also like to invite our friends from Dubai, the South African Business Council, so that we're actually being beamed now around the world, including Dubai, which I believe is 2 hours ahead. So it's 9:30 there in the evening. I would also like to invite our guests from Fidelity Services Group and Mr. Val Bartman. Welcome and thank you so much for joining us, because this is a regular thing. As I said, we've now had, I think this is our seventh week. Next week is going to be our final interview, and I'm going to make an announcement about that. But as Andre has said, it's been an absolute privilege to interview some of the greats of South African rugby. I mean, the likes of John de Villiers, Skulk Berger, John Smith, Brian Habana. And then, of course, a few weeks ago, we interviewed the class of 95. I mean, that 25 years ago, that incredible performance at Ellis Park, of course, that perhaps had a bearing on the future of South Africa. Last week, I interviewed the most capped Springbok, Mr. Victor Matfield. And tonight, of course, we've got a very special guest. But before I go any further, I'd like to just show you some of the skills of this man. Terry, we've got a short video, I believe.
We'll be right back. the way, and they might get a chance here to bounce it out a little more.
I'm a true champion.
It's an absolute pleasure, ladies and gentlemen, to introduce to you tonight, as I said, a World Cup winner and South Africa's most capped prop of all time, Tendai the Beast Mtawarira. How are you? Tendai, are you there?
Yes, I'm right here. Thank you so much, Dean. Thank you for having me. And thanks to everybody for joining in.
Oh, pleasure. Now, first of all, I've got to apologize, of course. It's not the first time an Englishman has said your name wrong. It has taken me all week to learn how to say it, and there I go, I probably failed again. So if you don't mind, we're going to refer to you as the Beast, as we all know and love you. So how have you been finding lockdown, Beast? How's it been over the past few weeks for you?
Yeah, no, so Dean, it's obviously been quite a challenge, you know, being stuck in the house for so long. But probably the biggest positive I've gotten from all of this has been spending time with my family. You know, I literally came back from the US about 2 weeks before the lockdown. And then, literally had to self-quarantine and then went into this long extended lockdown. And then I got to spend time with my wife and kids. And I think I really got to know another side, to my kids that I didn't know, beforehand, because, through your rugby career, you're always away from home. So now I was kind of, doing homeschooling with them and spending so much time and running around in the garden. So I was grateful for that. I always try to look for positives, in the worst of times.
As I said, Beast, I've had the privilege of interviewing, some of your teammates and Springbok greats, and they've all said the same thing, that actually it's been a positive in terms of that, spending time together with family. But you mentioned homeschooling. Have you turned out to be a decent teacher?
Dean, I've had to try and, teach the kids. I think my wife has probably been the one that has kind of been leading the way forward. My little boy is like my project. He's about 6 years old. So I kind of took him under my wing and tried to do all his, his homework with him, and his teachers would send him stuff. So, I was trying to, obviously understand how the way they do things nowadays, which is pretty different from when we, went to school. So it was quite a challenge, I must say.
Well, I, as a teacher myself, I don't envy you, I must admit. I mean, as I said, there's been a lot of people probably glad that the announcement here in South Africa that the kids will be going back to school, albeit in stages, from next week. So I'm glad about that. But listen, I want to take you back tonight. I want to take you back to your early days. I mean, this isn't going to be a story from birth to the current state, but we've got to talk about your young days. Now, I am a massive fan of your home country, Zimbabwe. I was fortunate enough to go there and to do some talks there. I've written a book about cricket. The actual title is Empire, War and Cricket. But one of the things I've talked about is the Logan Cup, which you probably know is the biggest domestic trophy in Zimbabwean cricket. So it took me there. But what I was absolutely amazed with was the absolute, friendliness of the people and the passion they have for sport up there. Now, you were born in Harare in Zimbabwe, of course. And then you went to Churchill School, didn't you?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Then I was born and bred in Harare. And I went to Churchill. That was my first high school. So in Zimbabwe, we do O-levels and A-levels. So I did my O-levels at Churchill, and then I did my A-levels at Peterhouse. And I think that's where, rugby began for me, at a young age. I actually started playing rugby when I was about 9, 10 years old. I was introduced pretty late in my school. And then, I was a big boy. And before that, my love was actually soccer, believe it or not. That's pretty crazy.
So I understand. I don't know if I should admit it, but I think you're a Manchester United supporter, aren't you? I don't know if you want to admit that at the moment with Liverpool's success, but Peter Schmeichel was a big idol of yours, wasn't he?
Yes, he was, yeah. I kind of wanted to be a goalie, for Manchester United. And, I think my dad had a huge part to play in that because he was a, avid soccer fan. And, and then obviously I was kind of clueless when it came to soccer, but when rugby came along, I was this big lad, and I could now use my, kind of my physicality, on the sporting field, yeah.
Well, let's face it, talking of physicality, I mean, that isn't that where the nickname Beast came in primary school? Perhaps you would have made a good goalie, but wasn't it your friends at primary school decided you were getting a bit of a handful there, so they gave you that nickname?
Yes, I got that nickname, you know, when I was around about that age in primary school. And like I said, I was a bit of a man child, so I was bigger than the rest of my peers. And, my friends kind of, got together and tried to come up with a nickname for me. And I think X-Men came into the picture. And then before I knew it, they called me Beast. And then it kind of stuck, until now. So it's pretty crazy.
Well, I always remember playing rugby at school, and it was always that big lad that you feared, of course, the one that grew quicker and was tougher than everybody else and would just run through everyone. So I can totally get where that name came from. But you moved to Peterhouse Boys School, you got a scholarship. And I think, am I right in saying that's really where your rugby got serious, where you had the facilities and the support to actually look perhaps at a future in the game?
Yeah, so I think I pretty much discovered that I was really good at the sport when I was 15, 20, 16. So I was still at church all the time, but I knew that for me to kind of step onto, onto the next stage, I needed to have the right facilities. And Peterhouse was probably, the dream school for me, because they're obviously a private school and they've got a lot of things going on for them there. So I always kind of dreamt of, kind of going there, and I had a cousin there. So, it was a big mission for me, to get into the school. And eventually, they agreed to give me a scholarship, a sports scholarship, and I was able to go and pursue, my A-levels, meanwhile having the base facilities and also, being able to eat as much as I can.
Yeah, I'm sure the canteen there at Peterhouse School certainly took a hit when you turned up, that's for sure. Now tell me, was I right in when I read about this, you were spotted really at the age of 15, and were you invited to play in an under-19s tournament at that stage? So you were playing ahead of your years.
Yes, I was obviously, like I said, quite big and, quite destructive on the field. So, I was kind of trying to get through the age groups, at Churchill. And then the first team coach at the time decided to put me, into the first team for a couple of games because he obviously saw my ability. And I actually didn't enjoy that because I just wanted to play with my friends in my age group. And then I wanted to, progress naturally. And so he tried to obviously bring me into the first team before my time. So, I used to come and sit on the bench. I used to play like the under 16 match, before the first team. And then I go sit on the bench for the first team. And it was kind of awkward because I had to play almost like, a game and a half, on a match day.
Wow, great experience though. And how did it come about that you signed for the Sharks? Because we all know you're one of the legends of the Shark Tank there, of course. I mean, I've had the privilege of being in that wonderful stadium and hearing the crowd shout your name. How did that come about? How did you get the move there?
Yeah, so, when I joined Peterhouse, they used to do a lot of school tours to South Africa. And I happened to come on the tour in 2003 to Durban, and we played a couple of schools. It was called the St. Henry's Festival. Yeah. So it was pretty big. A couple of schools came over, and obviously Peterhouse was invited. And it was there, where I really stepped up and just played so well. And I was captain of the Peterhouse first team. And in the crowd, there was one of the scouts from the Sharks, a guy called Barry Angus. He was actually the conditioning coach of the Sharks at the time. And then he obviously was impressed with what he saw, and he contacted Hans Scribber, the guy who was managing the Sharks Academy, to come and see me. And they came and watched me in my next game and offered me a sports bursary and just to come and study, and also like a small contract. And for me, it was obviously like a dream come true, coming from Zim. I really wanted to come and pursue a professional career in South Africa.
That's incredible. I mean, obviously the climate of Durban probably suited you as well. I think that was probably one of the things. Did you have options from any other the clubs? I mean, did the Cheetahs come in for you? Did a move to Bloemfontein perhaps?
I think at the time I had an offer from Western Province, and then there was another offer from the Lions, and that happened at Craven Week. But I kind of wasn't really excited about, you know, those two, because my heart was with the Sharks. I was always a big Sharks fan growing up in school, and always watched, you know, a lot of the legends, Gary Tushman, Boot James, you know, John Smith, and I just kind of was, really attracted to, you know, to the Sharks. So I knew that, you know, for me to get into the Sharks Academy was everything. So when it happened, you know, it was surreal. I couldn't sleep for a couple of days.
Amazing. Well, if it wasn't going to be Manchester United, then it sounds like the Sharks had your heart, didn't it? But I don't know if a lot of people know this, but it was your around that time, sort of 2007, when you're just breaking through, that was when the big change happened, wasn't it? You actually changed position. So you were a loose forward originally. I mean, that always been your position through school, and then you were persuaded, or somebody probably advised you, that prop was going to be your preferred position. How did that happen?
So I played in the back row pretty much my whole schoolboy career. So when I got scouted by the Sharks, I was, you know, number 8. So I got to the academy my first year. I was 19 at the time. And then I literally played my first year for the under-20s in the back row. I was pretty, not tall enough, you know, I was quite short. So, you know, Swayze De Bruyne, our coach at the time, was just trying to, you know, give me game time, because he saw, you know, that I was very explosive, and I could get around the park, and I could carry the ball really well. And his whole philosophy at the time was that, you know, he just needs guys who are hungry to play on the field. So even if you play out of position, don't worry about it, because you're just out there, you know, to showcase your talent. So we had a guy like Ryan Konkowski playing at number 13. Keegan was playing sometimes, scrum up, you know, so you kind of just mix the guys around. And then in the following year, obviously, I was, you know, kind of not really sure of where I would end up, because I had been told a few times that, you know, I'm not tall enough to jump in the lineouts. And then Dick Mio, was the Sharks coach at the time, called me into his office, and he said, "Hey, Beast, here's the thing. I really see you, progressing and becoming a star athlete, a star Sharks player. And for you to do that, I really think that you have to change positions." And then he obviously, asked me to change positions to the front row. And I think at the time I wasn't 100%, you know, into the whole idea, because, you know, there was a lot of, negative talk. A lot of people said, "Hey, it's going to take me a few years to master the technique," you know. And this was like in June 2006. So we were actually playing Curry Cup at the time. So he kind of asked me to drop out and just go and play a few club games and try, work on the technique. And Bali Swart took me under his wing and literally taught me, you know, all the things I pretty much knew my whole career. And he literally used to make me move around with a notepad and just, you know, write down all the stuff, you know, all the particular things that I need to be a successful prop. And then, I literally eventually bought into the idea, and then it took me about 6 to 7 months to actually play my first game for the Sharks.
Incredible, incredible to actually learn a new position. Now you've gone on to be a world record breaking player in that position. I think we've got a picture, Terry, haven't we, of Beast in the Sharks gear. I'd just like to bring up, because there's an interesting story. You can see here, there you are in the famous black and white there. The caricature on the right there, Beast, actually, is done by a young Durban artist called Junior Valentin. And Junior contacted me and said, "Please, could you get hold of Beast, and can we please donate this to Beast Foundation?" So we'll get you in contact afterwards, which is nice. It's quite a nice likeness. I think it's quite flattering for a caricature, that one, isn't it?
Yeah, no, it is. It's really cool. And I'm grateful. I'll thank him in person. I'll probably send him a message, but and I'll treasure it.
Pleasure. No, thank you for that. Now, I want to move on now to the incredible 2008, which is a memorable season for you, because now you've established yourself in the Sharks team. You're a Super 14 star of that team. But the big day, I hope for you, was the 14th of June 2008, when you made your Springbok debut against Wales. I've asked all the guys that have been on week after week, and I'd love to hear your memories of that day. Can you remember when you got that call and what it was like that day when you actually stood there and heard that anthem for the first time?
I think it was truly amazing. And I think the whole call up for me, you know, was really big, because I never really expected it to happen so soon. You know, I just become a Sharks player, and you know, I made my debut in 2007. I was just trying to find a way, you know, sort of define my position in the starting lineup at the Sharks. And then 2008 came, and then obviously got the starting berth, and then just started, you know, putting on performances in the Super 14 back to back, and got noticed by the, you know, the Springbok coach at the time, Peter de Villiers. And then he actually came, I think we were playing in the semi-final against the Chiefs at home. He came, and then he asked me if you know, if everything was in order in terms of my paperwork. So I was like, yes, I've been here for about, you know, 4 years, you know, in the country. So under IRB laws, I was qualifying to play for South Africa. And he asked me to get ready for the June test. So I remember, I couldn't believe it, and I had to literally pinch myself. And I went and told my really good friends, JP Peterson, about it, you know, because I was so excited. And then June came, he picked me into the Springbok squad. And I was rubbing shoulders with the likes of Victor Matfield, Scott Berger, Brian Abana, guys that were idols to me, you know. So I just felt like I was working among giants. And then, I had to wait for my first test, because the first game he didn't pick me. And then he picked me for the second test against Wales in Pretoria. And I just remember the whole week, you know, I was nervous and so, you know, excited. I had butterflies in my tummy and I couldn't sleep. And, you know, and then eventually when Friday came, that's when you know, they do the jersey presentation. And, you know, when I actually held that jersey in my arms, that's when I realized that this was really happening. And I felt, you know, so much pride. And I felt like, you know, this is everything. This is what I wanted, you know, from day one, to become a test player. Now I get this opportunity, and I was just thinking to myself, I don't want to let the country down. I don't want to let my teammates down. I just want to go out there and just do well. And then, literally the following day came, and then singing that national anthem, I felt so much, you know, so much passion and so much energy. You know, it was just an incredible atmosphere, as you know, the Loftus, you know, the fans really sing their hearts out. So I just remember like that energy rubbing onto me, and then having a great test. Yeah.
Oh, fantastic. And no better place to make your debut than Loftus, of course. Now, we've got something in common, and we're both adopted South Africans. And I need to read this quote because it rang true with me. I've been here since the mid-90s. I fell in love with the country. I went to Stellenbosch University. But of course, to most people, I'm still an Engelsman. I've still got that funny accent. But I feel South African. And when I read this quote from you, Beast, when we were talking about, you know, moving from Zimbabwe and whatever, it really rang true. And I could just read this out. You said, "I'm a South African at heart. I love the country. It has become my home. It is everything to me. Wearing the green and gold of the Springboks is a huge honor for me. That jersey is part of me. The green and gold flows in my blood. I feel just as much pride as any other guy in that team." And I think that sums it up. So I was exactly the same when I was watching you on the 2nd of November 2019 in a room full of English people, and I felt South African. And it's a really unusual feeling, isn't it, when you come to a country and you make it your home. And I think that quote summed up everything. So have you always felt part of that Springbok team? Have you always felt part of that Springbok family, despite coming from Zimbabwe?
Yeah, no, certainly. I think, you know, from that first... test match, you know, when I literally, you know, put on that jersey, and I felt more South African than, you know, than anything, you know, felt that I was going out there representing, you know, my home country, my obviously adopted country, but I just felt like, you know, this was home for me now, and I was going to represent, you know, South Africa to the best of my ability. And also the guys around me, you know, Brian Abanas, you know, they really accepted me. You know, I became part of a brotherhood, and that's one thing that kind of, you know, I never took for granted, you know, all along my career. So from that first test match, you know, I just wanted to go and play every single test match, you know, like it was my last, you know. And then before I knew it, you know, I'd played 25 test matches, and then 50 test matches. Then obviously I dreamt of, you know, reaching the 100 test match milestone, and I worked so hard. And I think it probably came with, you know, some really, you know, back-to-back challenges. But I just, you know, kept on working on, looked past everything, and defy the odds, you know, to reach that, you know, immense, you know, milestone.
No, it's an incredible. You're part of the Centurion Club, of course. It's a special club that's named after the Springboks that have played 100 matches. But we'll look at that in a second. But you mentioned the challenges. Now, tonight, this whole interview, and thank you again for being part of this, is in aid of the Players Fund, which, as you know, is the official charity of the Springboks. They support the injured players. The people, players have been injured as a result of playing this wonderful game. It's a fantastic game, rugby, but of course it comes at a price sometimes because of the physicality of it. But you had a different challenge, I understand, to overcome in terms of a medical condition. You had an issue with your heart. Can you explain what that was all about and how you got through that?
Yeah, that was probably one of the scariest things that has ever happened to me. It started in 2010. It was just a normal day. We were actually playing Super Rugby. And I was, at lunch with the boys, had a cup of coffee, and then next thing I just felt my heart beating so fast, you know, it was literally like I was on the field, but I was sitting down. So, you know, I gave our doctor a call, you know, and panicked, and then they rushed me over to a cardiologist, and then figured out that I had a heart arrhythmia. And yeah, the first thing, when you hear that you've got a heart, some kind of condition, you know, you start fearing for your career. So that was probably, you know, the biggest thing that hit me. But, you know, the cardiologist was like, you know, this is not life-threatening. It's probably, you know, won't stop you from playing rugby, but it's going to be something that is going to be ongoing and it's going to slow you down. So you have to eventually get it sorted out. So, what they used to do every time when my heart kind of came out of sync, I had to go rush to the emergency room, and then they used the defibrillators, and then they shocked me literally back to life. They knocked me out, then they shocked me back to life, and then my heart is like literally back, you know, into sync. So yeah, it was quite unusual, and then I just kind of just, you know, thought to myself, you know what, this is a challenge, and I think my faith came into play, because, you know, I'm a very I'm a strong Christian, and my faith has always been my foundation. So I just, you know, went down on my knees, and my wife, you know, just supported me, my family, and I knew that, you know, God was going to use it for something, you know, greater. So I just kept on, you know, being faithful and just trusting. And then I played with this thing for like probably about 6 months, and then I eventually had to go to Cape Town to go do this process called ablation by this famous doctor. They put the catheter in your groin, and it goes all the way to your heart, and then they burn out all those little electrodes, they call them. They kind of, you know, cause your heart to get out of sync. And so I had to go do that. They told me that I can't do any sporting activities for about 2 months. So at least, you know, it was, off season. So I was able to recover and then literally come back and play Super Rugby. But, it just didn't go away. It came back again. And I had to go for another ablation and then sit out for a couple more months. And then literally the following, it was probably the third year for it happening, on tour before the Irish Test in Dublin. I'll never forget this. I was getting ready to play. Then next thing, Friday night, this thing just comes back again. And I remember breaking down and just, you know, crying in front of our team manager, Charles Vessels. He teased me about it today. But I literally broke down because, you know, I was like, I don't understand why this thing is, you know, trying to hamper my progress. And then I had to leave camp, you know, I was put on the next flight out, came back, I had to go again for this ablation. So, you know, three times, you know, I had to do it. So it was pretty tough, but I just kind of kept on being faithful, kind of kept on, you know, being, you know, trusting the Lord. And then eventually, you know, after my third time, it never came back again. I think I was probably in my best shape ever and played some of my best rugby, and obviously went on to win a World Cup. So, yeah, just a testimony of, you know, staying faithful.
Incredible, incredible. And like I say, overcoming that hardship, scary stuff, as you said. My heart was beating just listening to that story. But what I want to do now is just put probably my favourite image. I've looked at a few images from your career, and I think the next one is my favourite one, because on the 16th of June, 2018, this happened. You actually had your 100th test against England, and look at that beautiful family. And you talk about faith, you talk about support and family. That must mean everything. What was it like that day when you achieved that incredible goal with them around you?
It was amazing. I think, you know, to be able to run out of the tunnel with my, you know, my kids was something, you know, that will be engraved in my heart and my mind forever. And it was just truly, you know, yeah, truly special. And my daughter wasn't actually keen to run out with me. She was like, no, I'd rather stay in the tunnel. But I was like, no, we have to go. This is, you know, this is a big occasion. I need you guys to, you know, be there for me. And my boy was really excited. And yeah, I think, you know, it was just an incredible moment. And for me to kind of, you know, get there as the, you know, first Black African player to play, you know, 100 test matches, was just, you know, probably a testimony to my whole career, you know, all the challenges I faced. And I just kept my head down, you know, I stayed focused and just kept on working hard. And then eventually, you know, just started breaking all those barriers, you know, and I really never probably focused on them, you know, like, I want to do it. I just kept on doing, you know, what was necessary. And then eventually when I got there, it was just, it was incredible. And, yeah, I think the whole game, I think, you know, for us to win it as well, you know, against England, a worthy opposition, you know, I think was just the, you know, the cherry on the cake. So I'm just so grateful that, you know, I could do it with my family. My wife, you know, has been alongside me the whole journey. She sacrificed a lot for me, you know, and supported me through everything. So, yeah, I'm just, yeah, so grateful, man. And, yeah, I'm getting goosebumps right now just thinking about it.
Well, I want to, if you don't mind putting that second picture up again, I want to ask Beast about another member of the family, because he's got a quite an interesting little dog here. And I think he's quite an important member of the family, isn't he, Beast? Because on one hand, there you are, look at that, lifting up, you know, 120 kilogram man. And on the other side, we can see the other side of you. There we are, the teacher. But who is that? Who's that little boy in the corner there, the dog?
Oh, that's Milo. His name is Milo. He's a French bulldog, and my kids are absolutely nuts over him.
No, it's lovely. I mean, talk about keeping grounded. I mean, it's interesting that you keep mentioning playing England, and of course, the big game we're going to be talking about coming up. But you had your 100th test against England. The other record I've got to mention, you hold the record for the most Super Rugby caps by a South African, 160 appearances, which is quite incredible, because this has come about with determination. If we can look at the next couple of images there, Terry, I think the training image of Beast and the determination you can see, because you were preparing, of course, for 2019. And that was going to be historic in many, many, for many reasons here in South Africa. I mean, this is the wonderful poses we can see, you at your height there. But the next image here, this is the hard work that you have to go in, certainly as a modern prop forward in rugby. Look at that. I mean, what is that all about? I mean, is that what you do? You literally crawl around with resistance in training?
Yeah, so this is this was probably one of our you know, main training methods when it came to scrummaging. You know, we used those elastic bands to, you know, to kind of work on you know, your hip extension and getting into good body shape. And yeah, that just became second nature to us. So I probably was one of those guys who was kind of, you know, obsessed with the bands. I used to do it all the time because it obviously added a lot of value, you know, into my scrummaging and just made me that much of a better player. So yeah, I think it was a great part of the, you know, whole World Cup preparation.
And now we've got to come to it. I've been dying to talk about 2019, of course. I mean, we've covered the 1995 historic win, 2007. A lot of the players were involved in that I've spoken to. But 2019, last year, I mean, I know how important it was to me. But was there something special about that team? I mean, I'm going to ask you several questions here, and please cover them. Was it all about Sia as captain? Was it the role of Rassi and how he embraced that team ethic? I mean, were you destined to win? Why was 2019 going to be the Springboks year?
No, I think there were a lot of parts to it, and I think everything just came together. I think when it came to the actual squad, I think if you remember in 2016, 2017 was probably recorded as you know, the worst years of Springbok rugby, and at the time, you know, we were losing to, you know, you know, teams like Italy. We lost to Argentina, and it was, we were the lowest of all lows, you know. And I think for myself, probably to be one of the lost kind of members of the, you know, the team that kind of, you know, moved on. You know, guys like, you know, Victor left, you know, and then obviously Brian was still there, but he stopped, you know, playing, and then I became like the lost member, and then just kind of felt like, you know, this is not what I'm used to. You know, Springbok, you know, the Springbok brand stands for excellence, and this is unacceptable for us to be performing this way. And I remember contemplating on actually retiring, because it was, it was just not, you know, not part of who I am, you know, to actually, you know, come back home and try and see fans that, you know, support the Springboks, and they have to endure such terrible losses. And I think, you know, going through all that pain as a squad, you know, kind of brought us together. And I think Sia was actually injured most of the time. And then when Rossi came in, you know, he obviously came in with a plan, and he was very honest and told us that, hey, guys, here's where we are. World Rugby sees us, you know, like this. And this is the way we're going to fix it. You know, there's a lot of things that are wrong with South African rugby. You know, there's people not working together to contribute to the ultimate success of the Springboks. And he literally, you know, I was honest. You know, he went to, you know, into detail, into everything that we need to work on fixing transformation, and you know, addressed all this, you know, big elephants in the room that other coaches before him, I can tell you for a fact, didn't want to talk about, because, you know, otherwise, you know, it will become bigger than it's you know, it's supposed to be. So they kind of ran away from that, but they didn't actually know that there's actually, you know, it's actually taking our power away from those issues by talking about them, you know, and addressing them to the team. And then Russell did that. And then obviously from a playing point of view, he told us that, hey, guys, we're going to have to work harder. We are going to have to really, you know, be desperate to play for the Springboks. Because, you know, it's a huge honor. It is the biggest honor you will have in your career to play for the Springboks. And the Springboks have won World Cups before. They've won big, you know, big championships. You know, we've won the British Lions Series. We've been number one in the world. You know, we've beaten the All Blacks, you know, three times in a row in 2009. And we, you know, we're such a great symbol, you know, for hope for the country. You know, he said all these things and just really, you know, hit the nail on the head. And I think for myself at the time, and I was thinking, hey, maybe, you know, I should stop. But my biggest desire was to win the World Cup, you know. And when he came in, I just addressed us like this, the way he did. You know, I was just like, you know, I'm 100% in. I'm going to buy into this guy's plan. And then everybody did the same thing. You know, everybody had to go back to their provinces. And we all worked hard. And eventually, when it came together, you know, and the Springbok setup, everybody kind of knew what was expected of them. And then we played, you know, in those, you know, English test matches, you know, the first three test series that he was coaching. And yeah, from there, he had a whole plan, you know, from the first test, he had a plan. He said, guys, we've got about, it was about 18 or 19 tests towards the World Cup finals. And he said, you know, our goal is to get to that final and win it. And, you know, imagine that he said it from the first test match, and he knew step by step that this is the way, you know, this is the route we're taking. And he said that, you know, along the way, we're going to have a few losses. We probably, you know, not going to win everything. But the fact of the matter is that we're not going to lack in effort. We're always going to make sure we work hard and we give it our best shot. And if we lose a couple on the way, it's fine. But we know the bigger picture. So, you know, it was, you know, it was everything coming together. And then Sia being captain, you know, just kind of, you know, united everybody, the whole country. You know, it was the first time, you know, a Black African player was named as captain. So it was just powerful. It kind of just came at the right time. And Sia is such a powerful, you know, symbol of hope. You know, what he came through and his story is incredible. And, you know, everybody, all the guys had so much respect for him, and he led from the forefront. And then, yeah, so we just kept at it, improving bit by bit. And then at the end of the day, you know, we shocked the world by you know, turning it around in 2018 and winning a World Cup in 2019. So pretty incredible story, yeah.
It was an incredible, incredible achievement. And on behalf of everybody watching, thank you so much for what you did for South Africa last year, because we all needed a lift, and that's exactly what you gave us. And that's what sport can do, of course. And I've got some wonderful images from you lifting the trophy. What was it like to actually get your hands on that Webb Ellis trophy, beast? I mean, can you remember the emotion of it? Did you, I mean, because you were at the end of your career, of course, and look, just look at the emotion here. It's fantastic. Just take a moment to look at those faces.
We're always singing the Springbok song that we always sing after a win. So it was just incredible. I think I can't even put it into words, you know, because it means so much. You know, I think for myself personally, maybe my whole journey, I think, you know, coming from Zimbabwe and going through all of this, you know, a lot of challenges, and just stepping onto that podium, you know, just reminded me of everything, of where I came from, you know. And I was just so grateful. I just remember being so grateful. And I knew, you know, that this was probably, this was my final test, and this is the way I wanted to finish my career on the highest of highs.
I think to go out as you did, was quite remarkable, and well deserved as well, to be able to go out on the highest stage. And I think we've got a picture, Terry, here of some changing room celebrations that, of course, have been quite famous as well. You had a famous visitor in the room. There you are lifting it. Of course, I think it's dawning on you there, taped up. But here's the man himself. I think, as a fellow Englishman, he was quite pleased that the South Africans won it if England couldn't. Don't you?
Yeah, no, he was. He was very, he was very humble, and he kind of just said that South Africa needs this more than England, and the boys were really impressed with how down to earth he is. You know, he moved around and shook everybody's hand, and exchanged a couple of words. So I think that kind of resonated with the boys, and I think they'll remember that for life. And for me to kind of be up close and personal and take a few photos, I'm definitely going to keep those, you know, frame them up, you know, at a good time, because I'm actually a big Prince Harry fan. I think he's a really cool guy. Yeah.
Talking of big fans, the lady that's controlling our meeting tonight, Terry, dear Terry, my good friend, she's a big fan of this next man we're going to feature. And of course, our eyes are all drawn to one thing here. Why, Beast, can I say, did you not don the South African flag like Faf did? That's all I'm going to ask.
Oh, geez. I think, you know, Faf was ready for this moment. Faf was like, he knew that the prince was coming. I think he had an hour notice that the prince is coming to say hello. And Faf was literally hanging around in his Speedos. And just waiting for him to come. So that iconic photo you took with him, he planned it. He planned it.
There we go. There's the photo opportunity. The official photo. Perhaps Faf will look back one day and he'll have a story. We'll have to get him on an interview, Faf. But listen, I know that a lot of people are watching tonight, and I don't want to monopolize this because a lot of people have got questions for you. So what we're going to do, we're just going to hand back to Andre now, and Andre's going to just take us into a little bit of an intermission here with some questions and give us some information. Back to you, Andre.
All right. Thank you very much, Terry. If you can bring up the donations board again. Well, actually, before we do that, let's go to the poll. Tendai, you are very loved, my friend. There are so many people on here. I just went to the Players Fund. I see there are 16 watch parties that I can see from that Players Fund thing. I don't know how many thousands of people are watching this. You are desperately loved. You are very South African. We we love you. And the other thing I just wanted to say, if ever Val doesn't want you for a job, I am a speaker. And with that voice, Dean, we could get him so many voiceover jobs. Hey, don't you think?
That voice definitely.
For a new job. For those of you who haven't seen the post, there's a couple of quick questions. If you want to do some questions, I see some of the people already asking questions there. But on the poll, if you're going to say, where did you hear about this event? Social media, email, it just helps us to advertise properly. Did you enjoy the event? Well, Tendai, I've got good news for you. We've got 100% hell yes. Not one single negative person in the room. And the people are saying, would I like an invite to a future event? One person is feeling grumpy tonight. But everybody else, 99% of the people say yes. And Dean, you're going to share this with us a little bit later on also about who's there. All right, I think we'll leave the poll up for a few more minutes. While I've got you here, I wanted to tell you about something quite special that the Players Fund has made available for a raffle. Is every single year they have this World Book. Look at this thing. It's a commemorative book. I've seen this before, and these are massive. This is a special edition that's been signed by the entire 2015 Springbok squad, and it could be yours. It's only 100 rand a ticket, which really is for free, and only 300 tickets are going to go on sale. And I know there's quite a few that have gone through. If you would like to buy one of these, go to Quicket, and we are going to be announcing the winner of the book next Thursday. So if you want to have a copy of this book, please go on to there. Let's have a look at some of the questions. Terry, if you can just put up the beast's face, because I need to get really close to the screen. Do you think, Beast, that's an interesting question, if rugby never worked out, would you have played cricket for Zimbabwe?
Oh, no, not a chance. I was never a cricketer, and I never was interested in the sport, so that would have never happened.
Here's a great question from Quinton van der Asfeld. One of your greatest and best performances was when you absolutely dominated, and I remember watching this game, poor old Phil Vickery in the opening test of the 2009 British and Irish Lions at King's Park. What recollections do you have of the game, and can you describe what it means to play against the Lions, and what are your thoughts on next year's tour?
That's a great question. I think playing against the Lions is probably the next best thing to playing in a World Cup. So it's such a big occasion and such a huge honor to be a part of it. And I think at the time, when I got picked, I was just really excited to contribute to the success of the team. And I was obviously quite young, I was 22. And I just wanted to make a mark in world rugby. And obviously, I'm sorry to Phil Vickery because I had no choice.
I think that was sort of the end of his career after that. Arthur Thompson is saying, thank you, Beast, you're the best. I think a lot of people are coming with that theme. Merrick has asked an interesting question. Now you've got to think about this one. Who would you be nervous about if you had to arm wrestle somebody in world rugby?
Oh, geez. Nah, that's an easy one. Urban Elizabeth, he's got biceps like I look like tennis balls in there. So he'll be hard.
Lindy's asked an interesting question. What's the strangest match you've ever played in?
Strangest match? I think probably in Argentina, in a place called Salta. It's quite a weird place to play rugby in. So I'd say that's probably the strangest venue that I've played rugby at.
Yeah, a lot of people are asking what it was like to play rugby in the US. Obviously, that's a sad story. You want to spend 10 seconds to tell us what happened there?
Oh, yes. No, it was a great adventure. I was really enjoying it. And I think after winning the World Cup, I just was looking for an exciting experience to kind of cap off my career. And I love America and everything it has to offer. And also having the chance to kind of grow the game globally was really exciting to me. So I was based in Washington, D.C., playing for Old Glory. And everything was going well until the coronavirus came and ruined everything. But anyways, it's one of those things.
Will you go back, Tendai?
No. That was probably my last season. So, it was probably not ideal to finish it that way. But I guess,
Any plans? Belinda's asking, any plans to go? She's obviously a Sharks fan. She's saying, any plans to come back to the Sharks in a coaching or mentoring capacity?
No, definitely in a mentoring capacity. I've always wanted to, impart knowledge into the next generation and, help, young players, come into their own and become successful professionals. So, I look forward to, working especially with the front rows, the Sharks, helping them on their scrummaging and then, general forward play.
Yeah, there's so many great comments. We'll make sure. Here's a sad one. Can you comment on the loss to New Zealand in the World Cup?
No, that's actually not sad, because I think that kind of, you know, led us to actually winning the World Cup because, you know, it made us work even harder. So, yes, it was a stumble in the blocks, but, you know, we didn't let it get to us. So, yeah, I'm actually grateful that we lost that game.
Dean, if I can have another minute or two, there's so many questions. A lot of people obviously know you. There's an interesting one from Salter, the interpreter Guadalupe, saying, "Hello, Beast, regards from Salter in Argentina."
Oh, wow.
And obviously one of your interpreters there. Paddy Doyle saying, "Hats off to you, Beast. I've always given, you've always given of your time to the Rovers. What role do you think club rugby plays nowadays?"
No, I think, yeah, I really think club rugby is important. And I think, you know, at Fidelity Services Group, with Val Bartman, you know, we play a big role in club rugby, you know, in Natal. So, yeah, I think, you know, it's really important for players to kind of invest in their time in their clubs, you know, and really be devoted because, you know, from there you can get better and then, you know, step onto the provincial scene and actually, you know, become a success. So I think, you know, I started off playing for Rovers and I played under 20s at Rovers. And then from there, you know, literally, you know, went on to play for the Sharks. So I think, yeah, it's a great place to start for a rugby player.
Yeah, there's lots of questions that we could be here all night. I'm going to end up with a lovely one here, and it's from Steve Richardson, and he's asking, "Beast, what's your favorite food?"
Oh, my favorite food, it would be steak and steak and chips. Yeah, that's probably
a nice with an egg, my friend. You've got to have an egg on there somewhere. Yeah. That'll be the perfect meal. Tendai, it's been an absolute pleasure having you. I think South Africa genuinely loves you. I think by tonight's numbers and just some of the comments and things like it. Definitely one of the most popular in the whole series, but don't let that go to your head. Be the same person you've always been, and can I pass it back to Dean?
Thank you.
Thanks, Andre. Now, some wonderful comments coming through there, and you can see the love that's in the room. So thank you, everybody, for joining in tonight. And we'll make sure that those comments reach the Beast as well so you can get the feedback, which is fantastic. So thanks so much. But I just want to finish up tonight, Beast, as well, by thanking you for joining us. But what's next for you? I know you've recently had a business announcement, so you could tell us a little bit about that. And the other thing I wanted to ask, how often do you get back to Zimbabwe? Because I believe you've got some charity work that you do there.
On the first question there, I've been involved with Fidelity Services Group for about 9 years, and I've had this really great association, and Val Bartman literally took me under his wing, you know, and became my mentor for so long. And it all started with me, you know, being the face of the business, you know, doing adverts, and then from there I actually became a shareholder, and then Val actually taught me about the business. So it's been a great start for me, you know, to prepare for, you know, life after rugby. So, you know, eventually when I, you know, came to terms with actually retiring, I decided to give me also an opportunity to run one of our main subsidiaries, a company called Umlindi. So I'm now the CEO of this new business, and I really have to work hard to kind of grow it. And you know, it's obviously humble beginnings, but yeah, you know, we got the full backing of Fidelity, and I'm still involved in the group. So right now I'm just, you know, learning as much as I can. I'm also busy studying towards an MBA with any business school. So, you know, my dream is to become a fully established businessman, and for that to happen, you know, I'm just going to have to learn as much as I can, as quickly as I can, and just really kind of get comfortable as quickly as possible too in the business world. And then on the second question in regards to Zimbabwe, yes, I'm in. I've been involved in a few charities there, and it's obviously pretty tough in Zimbabwe, and they need all the help they can get. So I've always tried to go back home, you know, from time to time. When I was playing, I was probably going there probably 4 to 5 times a year, and I was trying to, you know, do coaching clinics and then getting, you know, hands-on in the community, and, you know, try and inspire the, you know, the young men and women that, you know, they can rise above their circumstances and actually become great, you know, and not be, you know, not be conformed, you know, to the situation, you know. And the now thing is that they have to dream big. They have to think about themselves, you know, fulfilling big roles in big places, you know, and just kind of changing the world, you know, through what they do. So that was kind of my message to them. And I was involved in a Higher Life Foundation, which is run by a really powerful family from Zimbabwe, and I was an ambassador there, and I was involved in this also organization called Get Involved, which is run by a friend of mine. And the whole thing for me was just all about giving back. And right now I've just started my own foundation called the Beast Foundation, which is going to be in South Africa and in Zimbabwe. It's all about creating, you know, the next African future leaders, you know, through the platforms of sport and education, and just getting hands on, you know, in the community, dealing with, you know, social injustices. So my dream is really quite big, you know, when it comes to giving back. And I plan to do that a whole lot more now.
No, it sounds like you've got things mapped out. What I will say to you, I've had friends who have done an MBA, Beast, and I've got a PhD, and they say it's just as tough. So are you ready for that?
Right now, I'm just trying to get, you know, wrap my head around everything, get into some sort of routine. So right now I'm actually doing a postgraduate diploma, and then which is like the bridge, you know, to getting into an MBA. So I'm hoping, you know, to officially start my MBA next year. But right now I'm just trying to get, you know, back into the swing of things, getting, you know, into lectures and doing assignments. Yeah, but it's kind of stretching my mind. Yeah, so, which is good.
No, good for you. No, listen, it's been an absolute honor and a privilege to be able to speak to you. And as I said, thank you again for giving me personally so much joy last year in 2019. And I wanted to end with this wonderful picture, because that's how you played the game, with a smile on your face, with the determination. And there you are in your beloved black and white of the Sharks, of course. Now, ladies and gentlemen, before I go say good night, of course, we're coming to the end of this series. We're now, as I said, we've had 7 wonderful interviews with 10, I think, individuals. It's been absolutely wonderful. But next week is our final one. And so we've decided to give you something different, a big name, but not from the playing side, from the coaching side. I'm pleased to announce that next week we've got the architect of that 2007 World Cup win, Mr. Jake White. So please get your thinking caps together. If you've ever wondered how that team of 2007 came together, we're going to be able to interview. And there we are, Andre, with his book, of course, in black and white, Mr. Jake White. So I really would urge you, please, to, again, we're going to make it free. If you could please join us next week, spread the word, because that's how we make this work. It's all in aid of the Players Fund. And as I said, let's go out on a high. Let's try and beat the records. We've had several hundred in the room tonight. So let's try and beat it next week. And I'm really looking forward to that. So again, I would like to thank Tendai, and wish you all the best, Tendai, for your future. It sounds like you've got a great future ahead of you, in and out of the game as well. Love and best wishes to your family as well. And we're going to finish up now by going back to Andre for the wave, which is the customary way we end these meetings.
Tendai, it's difficult when you're doing these things to realize that there's so many people watching you. So what I could ask, if everyone can just do this, is a little bit of fun we do at the end of every single series. Just switch your camera on just for a few seconds. And one of the things that we'd like you to do is we'd like you to say thank you in the Zoom way. And the Zoom way is to just wave your hands like this. What Terry is going to do, she's going to play some music. And what happens, she will flip through the screens to show you all the people that are here. And Tendai, just say once again from ourselves and from the Players Fund, Dean, outstanding job again, as always, my friend. And thank you very much, buddy. So if you just want to switch your cameras on,
Morena Bulu, Kansi Chava, Sayasu, Ufeni.
guess. We'll see you next Thursday.
Good night, eh? See you.
We'll leave this up for a few seconds. If you would like to say thank you to the Beast and to the players for putting this all together, we'll leave this up for a few minutes. Any amount would help. It's for a fantastic cause. It's for injured players and rugby. You obviously know, all know that. If you'd like to donate a few rounds, that would be absolutely wonderful. Until next Thursday, looking forward to see you. Jake White. It will be advertised again on Cricket and on social media. So watch the Players Fund or one of our Facebook pages. And we will see you next Thursday, 7:30, for Jake White. It should be a good one.
Right, I'm stopping the meeting. Thank you, everyone. Bye.